say thank to thank Dijkstra, who is here and he's giving us an interesting talk about this. I'm pretty sure I know the topic and a method to determine optimal locations for measurements and those places where you have the largest amount of information. So just a short introduction of Enke. Enke is a professor of dynamic oceanography at the Institute of Marine and Atmospheric Research of the University of Utrecht. He's also the head of the Department of Physics. And basically, he is an expert of several things, oceanography and nonlinear dynamics, I would say, probably the two most important. He published three books on nonlinear physical oceanography, dynamic oceanography, and nonlinear climate dynamics. And he's a member of the Dutch Royal Academy of Arts and Science. He also received a medal from the EGU and from SIAM. And I'm very glad that he's here. And also because we are collaborating in a project that is focused on Lake Garda. So we recently also signed a memorandum of understanding between our department and the University of Utrecht to have a, let's say, a jointly effort on the activity of on the field work and modeling work on Lake Garda. Recently, Henk has also been appointed as a research fellow of our department, so this means that he will be back in Trento, well, several times in the next 2 years. So probably in October, when Henk will also give a course. The topic is ready to be decided, but the idea is to organize a course for PhD students. And next year again, we will see what we can organize. So, thank you for coming, and I give you the floor.
Thank you very much. So, thanks very much, Marco. Yeah, it's a pleasure being here. I hope to come back many more times to work on this beautiful Lake Garda. I was supposed to give a talk on phytoplankton blooms, because you know that's more associated with what we do in Lake Garda, but after talking Marco and Sebastiano last week. There was an idea on Lake Garda, you know, if we want to look for instance, deep mixing events in Lake Garda, where should we measure? And then I thought, hey, we did some work in the past looking at this optimal observation systems, and I thought it would be nice for you to see how we did that at the time, because it's very generally applicable. It's very general. I do it for one example, because we sort of our focus. But it's, you know, very general method, very easy to do, and you get a good idea on where the information is for a particular, where the important information is for a particular thing you want to predict. So this was work done quite a bit ago with Bernard Kramer, but also with an Italian, Stefano Perini in Naples, and then also Petian van Leeuwen, who is an expert in data assimilation, still studying at the moment. So at that time, we were interested in the Kuroshio. You see here the picture of the Japan. There's a current, I'll show you in a minute, floating here in Japan. You would say, why are you interested in Japan? Well, this is also quite an active collaboration I have with Chinese scientists, particularly in Qingdao. And they are, of course, close to this current also. And this is why, actually, this example came up. So to give you a bit of a background, In the ocean circulation, I mean very quickly, textbook picture. Here you have the major surface currents in the ocean, and we'll focus, as I said, on the Kuroshio current transports. Here maximum is about 60 swerdlups, so that's 60 million cubic meters per second. The maximum velocities are about 2 meters per second, so these are the highest velocities actually there are in the ocean. And what is nice is that there have been quite a measurement campaign, and this was by the US, so this was funded by NSF, but there has been now also follow-ups by the Japanese and by the Chinese on this Kuroshio current. And this is particularly an example of what the Crucio extension system study was doing in 2004. So they had all kinds of drifters. They had the spaghetti you see here is the sea surface height from satellites. So that's a particular contour of a particular sea surface height. And then you see that there were moorings, inverted echo sounders, all kinds of measurement instruments. And from this, ADCPs and moorings, there was a velocity profile that could be constructed. It's just perpendicular to the current, and you see indeed it's about, you know, it goes to 1,000 meters deep or so, and it has this upper ocean, say, velocities of 2 meters per second. So what we particularly focus on is the satellite images. So this is determined by altimeters, so that's the measurement of sea surface height anomalies. And from there, that's already long, that's since the early 90s, and what you see in this Crucio path is that it shows some peculiar behavior. It goes from a sometimes very straight jet, what you see here. So these are images, this is every 2 weeks, you have a contour of the 170 centimeter sea level, and you look at, you know, how it develops over the year. So you see 26 of those, say, curves in each diagram. And then you see points of the year where you see this big meander here, south of Japan, and say also a lot more, say, meandering, and a lot more, say, spreading out of those, say, contours. So it gives a suggestion that you actually have, you know, multiple paths, really more jet-like and really more meandering type paths. And it's interesting to, of course, to look at this variability, which seems to occur, you know, on a time scale of 5 to 10 years or so. Now, this is not, you know, without it's important for fisheries and this prediction of the current. The Japanese have a big system already in place to really look at prediction. That's something that, I mean, it's not topic of the talk here. It's just a nice example to look at this type of observation systems, how you would design those. Now, some important characteristics which we need actually when we come to look at models of this current. So here is particularly the path length. So this is from measurements. It's basically you measure the length of this contour, the arc length. And you see that particularly here in the say situation where you have a more jet-like structure, you see, yeah, okay, then the path length is not very long, so that's a low value. And when you get into this meandering state, it becomes very high. You see also enormous variability on there because there's eddies, right? And it's really complicated, it's a curved structure. And what you also see if you look at the upstream position, so we did the northern point of the Crucio extension, then you see that during this period where you have this, say, high length, relatively high length, you see that the upstream position moves northwards. So here it's relatively south, you see, and here it's more northwards. So that's also quite a nice characteristics of this, say, decadal variations of the Crucio. Now, how do you model this? Well, you want to try to, say, find a minimal model. And a minimal model I always sort of define as, well, you have enough physics in there to capture this type of phenomena you're interested in. So in this case, it's this path changes. But if you strip away some of those details, then the phenomenon is not found anymore. So it's very loosely defined, but it's sort of the minimal physics you need to represent the phenomenon under study. Now here it is a shallow water model, so you're probably familiar with those, right? Reduced gravity shallow water model, so you have a layer which varies in depth, which has a density rho, and then you have below you have a layer of which is a little bit heavier, rho plus delta rho. And then there's this surface here between these two layers of thermocline that's a deformable surface. So this is basically how you model the upper layer transport, and then the Crucio is what would be about, say, 600 meters or so, this depth of the layer, typical depth. And then you you force it by a wind stress only, so no heat flux is involved, only wind stress. This is the wind stress curl, and so that's the vertical component of the vorticity of the wind. So you see typically here, wind is going westward and high latitude winds is going eastward. And then you see the equations, well, U is the velocity vector, F is Coriolis parameter, And then you have a loose gravity here, which is the related to the density difference here over the layers. This is the free surface height. And then you see a term with this sort of lateral friction, so that's the, you know, the exchange of momentum due to sort of turbulent motions very easily represented here. And then there's the wind forcing, and then there's some bottom friction also, which is needed for damping, say, the velocity field. And then you have the contribution equation written in this form. So this is a relatively simple model, right, on this, say, on this particular situation. And we actually look at a steady wind stress, so we take just the annual mean, just to see how variability appears in this model. And in particular, our control parameter will be this this lateral friction. And then what was done was idealize the domain a bit. So basically, we idealized the coastline by some piecewise, say, constant parts. And we define also regions A and B. So B is mostly the region below. So that's below Japan, and then A is the, what we call the Kushu extension region. And this contour diagram is then again, it's a little bit, it's not so sharp, but it shows you again this curl of the wind stress, which is very idealized. So very simple system, right? You have a shallow water model, you force it with constant wind stress, and you think, oh, do I get these transitions in there? Well, yes, you can. Because if you lower this AH, so you lower the friction, there's all kinds of transitions and instabilities which will eventually give you this type of transition behavior. So this has been studied for a long time. I mean, some old result is just a little different geometry, is that if you go from very high friction, you imagine you have a unique state, you can actually prove that also. But when you then go to lower friction, so this is this AH, is in meters squared per second, so this is very high values. But when you go to, say, lower values, what you can see is that actually there will be what we call imperfect pitchfork bifurcation. So there will be different steady states in the system, and they will also eventually go unstable up to oscillatory instabilities. So for people who know that those are half bifurcations, and eventually they will have a very time-dependent flow, even with steady forcing, right, because of all kind of instabilities. In this case, it's just what we call shear instability or barotropic instabilities, which basically give you this variability. Now, the steady pattern, they show you whether you have this meandering state and you have this, say, more or less jet-like state near the coast of Japan. And if you do that a little bit more in detail, this was done by Stefano Perini and myself for quite a while back already also. Then what you find is that when you go to even smaller values of AH, so here you have already this oscillatory state, very small oscillations. So here this is the range of this energy in this section here, A. So you average over this section, just kinetic energy. And then what you see is that you get here this oscillatory motion, and once you're here, at the blue part, you see this, when you take a time series, it's already quite irregular oscillation here. So this is in time in years. So you see it has already this sort of low frequency type of variability, but still a small amplitude. And then once you get to, say, between 240 and 245 here, you see that the range is greatly expanding, and this is what we call a homoclinic transition. And so what happens here is that you get a transition to chaotic flow, and well, this part here, you can also show that it has possibly up enough exponents, so it means that the sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So this is just to show you, you know, that this simple model, just forced by steady wind stress, just due to the interaction and non-interaction of instabilities, gives you really quite complicated behavior. And even with this model, when you look at a model data comparison just based on this, say, upstream path length, and also this position, this is, again, the observations here. And this is the model. Now, ignore the dashed curve, that's something else. But look at this model, say, this is just a model year, right? So it's just here from 174, 175. Then you see you have also this, say, low path length, and it goes up to, say, high path length, low path length. I mean, it's not like what you see in observation in detail, but you still see that this, say, transition between low and high path length occur. And what's nice also is that during this transition, you see also this kinetic energy, sorry, this upstream KA position, you see it actually going northward also. So this is actually qualitatively quite a nice, comparison between the, altimetry and the shallow water model. Now, quickly to show you also that, I mean, it's not perfect. If you look at, say, annual mean patterns of the model here of the sea surface height, and just here's the annual mean of the, say, the observations, also is from altimetry, then you see that, well, it has the same features. Of course, the timing is not, you know, it's not that it's too much for such a model to be able to predict all the details. But still, what you see is that the patterns is a reasonable correspondence if you, say, evolve it from this large Meander state to small Meander state. And this is relatively robust. If you go to lower values of AH, then this is over quite a range. You see this type of variability. So just to convince you now very quickly that this is a relatively simple model, but it shows you it has features which can sort of represent this type of transition between this, say, two states of the Crucia. So to quickly summarize, this transition behavior there, which we fully understand, you know, also the physics, this is really, really well, say, the instability is driving this, the Hamiltonic bifurcation driving the bifurcation variability, has been worked out over a decade of work of not only my group, but also other groups. And then, as I showed you, this reasonable agreement with observations, at least, you know, good enough to try to say, well, now we're going to look at predictability, and we're going to look at where you should observe to sort of increase scale of your predictability of these transitions. So this is now coming to the main topic. And so you have a relatively, it's a chaotic flow. It has, if you look at, say, the energy here over this section S here, so again, just the kinetic energy, and you look at, say, one time series, you see that it spends time here, and then it jumps to a low energy state, spends time there, goes to a high energy state, and the behavior is quite erratic. And also, if you would start an initial condition very nearby, right, it would diverge relatively quickly, because it's chaotic. So this is the problem you face, but you clearly see that you have this high energy state and low energy state, and from this single trajectory, you already assume that you, if you look at the probability density function, that you would have, you know, a peak here somewhere and a peak here somewhere. So you have bimodal behavior. Now, how do you now look at, say, from the predictability aspect? Well, the first thing you're interested in is how this PDF, so I call it PDF from now on, how it will look like. So you cannot do that from one trajectory, or you could maybe very long trajectory. But what you can do is you take, say, initial conditions from a long run, and then you start from all those initial conditions. In this case, we have 512. You start an ensemble, and you integrate, say, all different, I mean, take in all the initial conditions are different. You integrate for 40 years. This was this blue one was the one from the previous slide. And then you get an indication, and you can actually sample the PDF pretty well. So you have 512 members, 40-year integration, and you can get the PDF from here. You just bin it. I think there was 25 bins or so. You do that, and then you get here. You get PDF, and you see it has a lower maximum here, higher maximum here. So this is actually what we call the climatological ensemble. So you just take different initial conditions, integrate forward in time, and you look just at sort of this is the equilibrium, you know, attractor equilibrium type of statistics on the attractor. So that's the long-term equilibrium solution to which it develops. Now we do only an energy E here. You could also take other quantities, right? But what we're interested in now here is basically looking at prediction of, you know, of this quantity E. So that's just an energy measure. Now comes, so how do you define, say, properties of predictability and looking at the value of the information? Well, the concept which is very useful here is called predictive power. And basically, it's related to the entropy of the related to the PDF. So the entropy gives you, maybe you remember, right? This is basically the Shannon entropy. It gives basically a measure of uncertainty in the variable x based on the PDF. So if you are not familiar with it, just see it discrete here. If you have a coin, right? You flip it. It's only head and tail. Then you know this probability is a half here for head and tail. And the log of a half, this is then you take the log 2, and you see basically you get a half times g say log 2 plus a half times log 2, and so the entropy will be 1. And that's actually the maximum entropy. It's actually the maximum uncertainty in that point with head and tail. If you would have a biased coin, so for instance, very biased, where you have only head, right, then actually your entropy would be 0, because then you have certainty. So this is measuring sort of an uncertainty measure in there. And how do you define now this predictive power? Well, basically it's defined as the entropy of this, say, climatological ensemble. So that's the one, you know, the equilibrium part. And then it's also the ensemble you simulate. So that's not the climatological one, but it's the one you start from a certain, say, box of initial conditions. You integrate forward. I'll show a picture below in a minute. And then you get also a measure of the ensemble. And if the entropy of the ensemble is the same as the climatological one, then this is 0. And so the predictive power is 0. If you basically do not, your ensemble is basically, the entropy is the same as a climatologic ensemble, so you don't have any additional information. I know this is not so easy to grasp if you see it for the first time, so I do it a bit slowly. Now, if the probability density function is Gaussian, so that's not in our case, then you can show that basically it is the predictive power is just the variance of the, say, the analysis, so the variance of your ensemble with which you're going to calculate, divided by this climatological ensemble variance. And so you see also that when this is 1, then predictive power is 0. Which makes sense, right? You have you do prediction with an ensemble, it's not better than the climatological one, there's no any additional information. So you have predictive power 0. So now, for instance, how do you show this? Well, this is a typical ensemble. You take, say, you put stochastic noise on the wind stress. This is a very small white noise with the same pattern, 10% of the main amplitude. And what you do, you start with an ensemble which has the same initial conditions. So you just have the same. And what you see is that due to the noise, also now the ensemble spreads. And you see after a while, this trajectory diverge. And after a while, after 40 years, you see you more or less have the ensemble which is similar to the climatological ensemble. But during this period here, where the ensemble is relatively small, yeah, you're spreading, so your entropy is much smaller, so you have actually high predictive power. So here the predictive power is high because, you know, spreading is low, and eventually it spreads very out to the climatological part, and so eventually predictive power goes to 0. So you could actually say, well, here there's a boundary drawn. Here we do it in the paper, we take just 0.25, but there is a criterion that says, well, you know, you can look at confidence interval of this predictive power, and when it includes 0, then basically you have a limit that your predictive power is not telling you anymore anything. And so that's basically setting the boundary of predictability. And so Griffiths and Snyder, who developed this, they call this a predictive lifetime, and it's here about 30 years or so. So it says your predictive skill will not be better after 13 years. It's not doing better than the climatological ensemble. Okay, now, what do you want now? If you want to look at where to measure, then what you want to do with an ensemble is you want to so move forward, but in the same time you want to assimilate observations into the, say, forward ensemble. This is how the weather prediction does that too, right? And so what you want is you want to assimilate observations, and then okay, and then what you want to do is you want to use this predictive power measure. You want to basically have it as a measure to look at the impact of observations. So if you assimilate an observation and the spreading ensemble gets smaller, you have a higher predictive power. This is the idea. Yeah. So how do you do that? Well, this is ideal for what we call particle filtering. And so what you do is, if you have this, say, the original, say, PDF of your model, and you want to improve that on the condition of your observations, then you can use Bayes' theorem to really update, say, the PDF based on the observations, based on the original, say, PDF you have of the model itself. And this looks like a very complicated formula, but it's not, right? It's just the formula of conditional probability, which you all know, PA slash B is P A and B divided by PB, and you do it for A and B switched, and then you equal, say, the PA and B, and then you get Bayes' rule. Very simple. Now the question is how you implement this, how you implement this updating every time. And the nice thing is that if you use particle filtering combined with an ensemble, then you can all do this offline. So you do the ensemble run, and then from the ensemble run, you can actually do basically the whole analysis on how the predicted power will change if you include, if you assimilate observations. So here we, you know, for Lagarde, I see Sebastian looking, if you want to do it for Lagarde and you want to have a measure of deep convection or so you have a certain observable, then you also, you would have to run a very big ensemble first to use this climatological, how the climatological changes. And then you would like to know, well, you know, if I include observations of, you know, surface temperature or deep temperature or something else, what would it do to this predictive power in that ensemble? Now, how do you do that? Well, this is a bit of math, but it's, I hope it makes it, I did it yesterday evening, just to get more clear. So you can write the model always as a sort of a discrete time dynamical system, where this is the x k plus 1 is the state vector at k plus 1. And then this is the propagator, so that's your nonlinear system, right, which really changes the system from xk to xk plus 1. And then zeta k is the noise, which you put on there. And then what you have is that you have n particles, so n was in this case 512. And then you look at the probability distribution of, say, of this ensemble, and it's just the sum of, say, delta functions with weights, right? Because you just have every weight, you have it on the particular particle. And initially, you start just with homogeneous, say, every particle has the same weight. Now what you do, you determine these weights, say, with Bayes theory, and you update the weights. So suppose you know this conditional probability of, say, the state at xk minus 1, given the observations at 1 to k minus 1. Then what you do, you step forward all the particles, so all the trajectories, so that goes to xk. And then you have this, next probability distribution. And at that time, you have a next observation becomes available, that's yk. And then what you do, you update, you know, the probability density function with Bayes' rule. So this was the earlier probability density function, and then you have this this conditional probability of the observations on the condition of the model, and that basically means how close is your state vector to the observations. And so you can do that by a weighting function, which is in this case H is the observation operator, so that maps xk to, for instance, the energy, and then this the difference between, say, the model determined value and the observed value of energy in this case squared, and then you scale it with the variance of the observations. And that gives you just an update of the weights from the Bayes rule. And so you basically see that and it's what you see in the picture here too, that if the observations here, if the PDF is, if the particles come closer to the observations, then they will have a higher weight. And so eventually the PDF will shift, you know, towards the more towards the observations. So this is what is called sequential importance sampling. It's basically an offline particle filtering technique to just see that if you assimilate observations, how your PDF is going to change. Now what happens in time, I mean, if you get, there might be particles who actually get very high weight, right, because they're close to observations. And so eventually you see that the ensemble degenerates. So eventually the weight will be, you know, all in one bin or something. Now this is something you can avoid, there's all kind of techniques for this, but we didn't want to do that. So we focused on something else, which basically makes it workable without the degeneration of the ensemble. So how do you do that now? Well, you basically define now what we call an identical twin experiment. I mean, you could do it also with observation, with real observations. So you could use real sea surface height data and sort of assimilate them into the model ensemble. But then you wouldn't know whether it's due to the model deficiencies or to, you know, your lack of data, or to say the assimilation technique, what is wrong, what would be, say, the mismatch. So we do really identical twins, so we get the truth from the model. So we don't have this model deficiency compared to observations. And so what you do is you take this, say, ensemble, you pick one realization as the synthetic truth. So again, this one is then the real truth in this, say, part. And then you assimilate this truth data, you assimilate them into the ensemble, just in the way I sketched before. Oops. So how does that work? Well, here we take, say, from the sea surface height of the model, we take at three points, we'll just take the sea surface height, say, signal. So here is the blue one, here is buoy A, so this is sea surface height in centimeters, and this is buoy B, and this is buoy C, and this is our variations. The blue one is the sort of from the model, and we'll put noise on there. I don't know why it disappears right now. It's the cable. So we put noise on there, Gaussian noise, with a 10 centimeter variability, and so the observations are the green dots here. So you see they spread around with this, say, standard deviation of 10 centimeters, quite a large Gaussian noise. And we assimilate those data into the ensemble. So buoy A, you see it's quite flat signal. Do you see this has much more variability in B, and this even C has much more variability. B has even very large variability, because it's related into this region where you see the high variance of sea surface height. So this is in color below here, the scale, I can see, I've forgotten that. But here's the high variances in B. C has a high variance also, but A has hardly any variance. Now, this is how it works if you do that. So what you do is you assimilate this data into the ensemble, and then you look at how the ensemble and the spreading of the ensemble is going to change in time. And so the mean here of the ensemble is the red curve, and the spreading is this red, area around it. And what you see is that here, boy A, well, you know, it takes a long time before it actually gets closer to the truth, and still you have quite a spreading around it. But when you take, for instance, here, boy B, then the spreading decreases very rapidly, and you're actually quite near the truth most of the time here during the integration. So you see boy B gives a lot better, say, increase of predictive power than the boy A would do. Now, if you look at the predictive power increase, so here you have the predictive power you computed when you assimilate data from A and from B and C. So what you see is that during the first year, there's actually quite an increase of predictive power. And then afterwards, the ensemble degenerates because the weights is really concentrated. You know, it's already at point B, for instance, very near the truth already. And so you have only basically a few ensemble members left which you can do the analysis with. And so that's not, as I said, there's techniques to restart the ensemble, etc. But we focus only on interest here in terms of how the predictive power increases over 1 year. So that's the most, say here, striking feature you see here in this figure. And so what you do, you calculate this predictive power, and you look at, say, here it's done over one synthetic truth, but what you can do is you can take all of those 512, you can take them, each one, as the truth. And then you can average, actually, this, say, ensemble, this entropy of the ensemble over all those different, say, cases. And then you look at the increase of this predictive power over 1 year. So, summary again. So what you do is, you know, you have this whole different set of ensemble members. You assimilate all the time, you assimilate one of the two into there, and you get actually measuring how these observations, how they control the spread of this ensemble. And basically is this set, and how that compares basically to the climatological ensemble. So it makes intuitively complete sense that if you have observations which restrict the spreading of this very much, then you get a high value of the entropy, and you get a high value of the predictive power. So how does it do that? You take one realization as the synthetic truth. You cut now these 511 particles, the other ones, you cut them up in 1 year chunks. So you really have 1 year only, because you're interested only in the increase of predictive power over 1 year, and you compute that. So here, you, for instance, you have an example. You start here, for instance, this state here, and you look at the ensemble. This is the climatological ensemble. And you look at, if you assimilate from here, you assimilate observations, you can look at how the ensemble spreads from there. Now, this is how it looks like if you include observations from point B. So that's the point B is located here. And you can actually do it, of course, because you look at the annual part, you can do it from different, say, states. So this is starting from the low energy state, this is starting from the high energy state, and this is basically starting from a sort of transition state. And when you start from the low energy state, you see here that here the truth is the of the sea surface height is the black ones, and the analysis you get after, say, 1 year is the red curves here. So you see you're actually relatively close to the truth. And what you see is that if you look at the increase of predictive power, so the color bars here, so red means that you actually have quite an increase of predictive power, and the blue ones means that you don't gain any, say, predictive power. If you look at the different, say, states here, the transition state, you see again that near point B, it does actually pretty well in terms of increase of predictive power. Here also, regions are always, say, high predictive power increase. If you look at, for instance, point A, which is located here, then it only basically picks up, when you start in a transition state, it basically picks up, you know, enough information to give you a reduction in the spreading of the ensemble. Oops. But if you have point A here, you look at the low energy state and the high energy state here, then basically you see that there's no increase of predictive power either. So if you're interested in looking at, you know, the development of the low energy state in terms of with observations of point A, it's sort of hopeless. Whereas point B would do, in all those cases, would do relatively well. Now, this basically defines, say, how you can determine optimal locations. Because what you do then is you look at, say, you take all the particles and you take data from all the locations. So you not only from point B, but actually from all the points. You do the same exercise. And you look at where the average 1 year increase of predictive power is largest. And then you find where it is largest somewhere here. It's near point B, where you actually have the largest increase. But you see that the increase is actually over this area here is relatively okay. Now, if you see where the observational systems are, so here KESS and KIR and Westpac, these are the current observational systems. They're not in the region where you actually, if you want to predict, say, transitions from the Curacao, they're not at the optimal location, except maybe here, this KESS here near Boise. But there's nothing here. So this is, I would say, of course, it's of course also motivated by other things than just making, say, predictions in this path. But I guess that basically from this analysis, which I hope you see, it's very general. You could do it with your own model too, with your own simulation. I mean, there's no restriction in terms of model setup. You only have to be able to run an ensemble. You have to pick up the observational, the observational characteristics that you want to do. And then you can just apply these techniques to look at, you know, where is your optimal location of observations for that particular prediction, if you would do an ensemble prediction. So to conclude, hope you have shown you that you can this particle filtering combined with this predictive power approach is actually, I think, a very nice type of approach. Because you can do it offline. There's no way you can actually, you have to integrate, say, the ensemble during the whole thing. You just have to do it offline and generate the ensemble before. The predictive power concept is nice. It has also much more connections. There's also there's connection to relative entropy. There's a connection to concept as what maybe you know, conditional nonlinear optimal perturbations, where you look at basically you take a initial condition around a certain approximate initial conditions around a certain point, and then you try to solve the problem for forward integration in a certain norm where the say norm is maximum, and if you do it linearly, it's called linear singular vectors. That's what's used in weather predictions. But if you use it non-linearly, if you just look at the nonlinear evolution, then it's called the conditional nonlinear optimal perturbation. And there's a connection between, you know, this optimal locations here and the structure of this, say, conditional nonlinear optimal perturbations, in that exactly where those, say, conditional nonlinear perturbations are located, you find also the optimal observation. And physically, I mean, I'm not going to go in detail, but what is the physics of it is that you have large potential velocity gradients here. If you don't know what it is, fine. Which basically control the instabilities and so the divergence of these trajectories. So, and that's where you have to observe, because then you know that's your spreading of the ensemble is controlled by those points. So also the physics of why that happens is very well known. And then as a last point, this is a very simple application where you do say single location, so univariate observations, but you can do it also with multi-location, multivariate observations, and you can optimize also this, say, predictive power for a number of quantities. It's a very general, say, concept. So this is papers we've produced over the last years. What I talked about is basically this paper here from Van der Kamer, and then it's been applied to several parts, also to, say, El Niño prediction, to go beyond predictability barrier. Also there you can actually indicate where you have to measure to do that accurately. And then this is the whole more my Chinese connection, where we work in connection with this type of techniques with this conditional nonlinear optimal perturbations. So we look at optimal precursors and also on optimal error growth, and this also on say our strategies to parameter sensitivity. So this is already available also on the web. So it gives you an overview. I hope I didn't forget anything. This is somehow the line of work which has been done. So thank you very much. I hope you got the picture right. If you want to know the details, you should talk to me anyway, I think. And I hope that Sebastian and Marco got the idea, you know, might be useful for Legarda. I think it is actually. And now we measure somewhere, right? But there's no really rational basis apart from, you know, there's some vague basis, but you want to have quantitative. I think it could actually be useful. Thank you very much. Thank you.